don't understand why my volume doesn't work. Interesting. Hello.
Guess what? I can see and hear you this time.
I know. It's so funny because my little, like when someone calls, it doesn't go beep, 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 beep. So I'm like, why isn't my volume working? But now it works. All right. So. All right. So what? So you figured it? You figured it out, I guess.
Yeah, you know, and I was like, I have to, since I don't do this type of modem that often. I said, well, gee whiz, I wonder if it's, you know, mine, but the laptop is less than a year old, and it's everything, so I got my friends to practice with me, and I was
good.
Like,
it's okay. The other day I couldn't, there was no volume on mine either. I actually ended up like rebooting one of my rebooted my computer and that worked. But another time I had a bad Wi-Fi signal. So being on the, you gotta remember when I'm on the road, it, you know, a lot of it could be just on me. So anyway, let's get right into it.
We will. And just let me just say first, it's a pleasure to be on the line with you and to meet you. And let me just say your energy just comes every single video, and you
know, you're
getting slow.
Now you're breaking up. Shoot. You're breaking up.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm going to stand still.
Okay, good.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, much better. Okay. All right,
I'm
good.
I'm going to stay still. Yeah, I'll stay still. Hopefully this isn't messing with the
There you go.
The,
all right.
But anyway, I just want to tell you how wonderful your videos are and how encouraging they keep me. This is, thank you so much.
You're
put out there. It makes life better for a whole lot of dogs and dog owners.
Oh, you're welcome. Okay. So what do you want to talk about?
Okay. So as I mentioned, I have a pit bull that I rescued on December 30th. She's female, 4 years old, got her from the shelter. She apparently had been in the shelter about a month or so, had been in a house with other dogs.
Okay.
Very sweet with people, loves people. As a matter of fact, I renamed her Sweetie because she's sweet. Anytime Seth's on a leash. So on a leash, she becomes the devil. And she wants to pull me all over the place. I can't use a flat collar on her because absolutely no control. Tried the harness, no control. Using a gentle leader, which she still tries to lead me. So the whole time, it's pressure on her nose here because she will not give it up. If she sniffs another animal anywhere in the world, it becomes search and destroy.
Got it.
So where we're at now, we've been together 2 months, nine weeks. Where we're at now is I took her to make sure that I wasn't having, you know, I've never had a pit bull before. I've had a dog before, which was a Kelpie. And so I wanted to know, did I need to speak pit bull or is this dog just, you know, I was on the verge of returning because I said, maybe we're just not right for each other.
Right.
Okay. So fast forward, it took her to a pit bull event last weekend. Gentleman worked with me on my leash habits. We've gotten better.
Excellent.
In the sense that you know, I my shoulder is not dislocated, so that part's good. But she's still highly leash reactive. The good thing was she didn't show any aggression towards the other dogs or anything like that. And she's just lonely. But there's nothing I can do about that. I'm a single woman living in a single apartment, and yes, she is the only animal that I can have.
Okay, so it's definitely not a pit bull thing, and Kelpies can Kelpies can be a handful too. You know that, so I mean, so
they can. But this one wanted me so much that I didn't know until the end everything that she had changed, to do. So
let's talk about this. Are you okay? So I don't train on head halters. So I know a lot of people have success with them, but I don't train on that. So I really can't give you a fair, you know, assessment on what to do with it. So we're a big advocate of prong collars.
Which I just ordered. Sorry. Hopefully it'll be here this week.
Good. So the cool thing is the prong collar is just a tool that if you put it on, that doesn't mean it's going to work. So the cool thing is somebody worked with you on your leash handling skills, which is actually just as important as the tool. So leash handling skills plus prong collar. Now you've got the you've got some training skills and you've got a tool that's going to help you have a better conversation with your dog. The most important thing is this. For right now, believe it or not, don't feel like your dog has to meet other... First of all, on the walk, I don't want your dog to meet anybody. And it's not a, an aggression...
I don't.
Good. It's not an aggression thing. It's a not... This is the thing. I don't, some of the most leash reactive dogs I have worked with go to daycare every day. Every day, they go to daycare. They're so excited to see another dog. You'd think they were aggressive, but they're not. They're excited. So what? It's no different than if you ever see, like when I play tug with my dogs, and so say there's somebody across from me, and they've got my dog's tug, and I'm holding my dog back. You would think she was the most aggressive dog ever. Nope. She wants that tug really, really bad. So it's sort of the same thing with leash reactivity with the dogs. Now, your dog might be aggressive or might not be aggressive, but that's not even the conversation. The conversation is, how can we get your dog to walk better on the leash? What I always tell people to do, don't let your dog meet dogs. Don't let your dog meet people. I want you and the dog to become one. It's your dog. You're the one at the end of the day that's going to be stuck with the medical bills, the food bills, the care. If you have to be out of, if you've got to be away for 10 hours, you're going to have to come up, have somebody come in and take care of your dog. So I want you two to become one. The best way to do that is I want that dog to always be interested in you and not interested in anything else. That doesn't mean you can't have a play date. That doesn't mean you can't have people over. But when it comes to the walk, you're a unit. It's you and dog as one. So the prong collar is going to help you have a conversation with that dog where the dog is going to be a little either at your knee or a little bit behind your knee. And what it's going to do is it's going to, as soon as that dog starts getting a little bit like, what's that? You're going to give a little bit of a pop saying nothing you need to know about. Now, your pops might have to be firm, they might have to be light, but it's the timing that makes the big difference. So if the dog is a little bit ahead of you and already starts getting alert, your conversation has to be louder. So the best thing to do, and it's the pop is going to be a sort of like back pop, not up. The up pop is to get the dog into a sit, so it's going to be parallel with the dog's body that you want to do. And again, the timing and the quickness is everything. So don't pull back, it's pop. So you have to release as well. So you can practice that. And on your dog, we work with so many pitties. You know how hard it would be? Everyone's afraid, oh, I'm gonna hurt my dog. It would be very hard to hurt a pitty with a prong. I mean, it's just like, you know, you got solid muscle there. So what you're doing is, it's more about that instant communication to the dog that says, you don't need to pull ahead. So that's how you're going to start walking your dog. And when you see another dog approaching, don't be afraid to create a little bit of space. Like right now, you don't need to prove that you can walk by all these dogs. I always tell people, I don't want you to run the other way, but if you've got a sidewalk and it's a narrow sidewalk, don't worry about like maybe moving out into the street a little bit. And you're not doing it like out of, oh my gosh, I'm afraid. It's just like, you know what? You need a little bit more space. I'm going to give them space. Let's go. Plus, you don't know their dog. And I don't trust other dogs or other people. They'll have no, I've seen so many dogs. I'll be walking two of my shepherds and you've got a dog that lunges at my dog and I'm hearing laughter in the background. Like, they think it's funny that their dog lunged at two German shepherds. And I'm like, that's why it's like, I'm not interested in that conversation. I'm not interested in any of that nonsense. I'm just trying to get through the day as easy as possible with my dogs. And so are my dogs. Right. So.
Agree. So that leads to the next question, which is two. The first one, I mentioned the dog before, the Kelpie I had.
Yep.
No problem with her being interested in me. Always her attention was on me. And I, you know, I was just a dog owner, didn't know anything about training. So this one, that's a major problem. She absolutely no attention to me once we're on the leash. When we're in the house and we're moving around and all this kind of stuff, her attention is on me and so forth. We get on that leash, it's a whole different ball game.
Okay.
And I've tried little squeaky noises. I've tried, you know, going Now, that much I do more now. I make the kissing noise more now to take some bass out of my voice, if you will.
Yeah.
But still, she's stuck on whatever it is that she's on. You know, she doesn't pay attention to me at all.
Right. So what I want, you to do is this. There's a video on, if you go into my YouTube channel, and right in my search box on my channel, if you just type in 180, there's a move that I do. There's a move that I do with a Rottie. We'll do this with a lot of dogs. And it's your dog might make an audible. Remember, you know, we're not trying to harm the dog, but it surprises the heck out of them. But what it does is it gets these dogs to all of a sudden, like so many dogs, when you're out in public, they have no idea that there's somebody holding the leash. They've got no idea. You're just like along for the ride. So this gets your dog's attention really, really quick. And it's a wonderful move, and it's you shouldn't have to do it all the time. What you're doing is you're just giving your dog a very, very sudden, like, jerk with the leash as it's going that way, and then all of a sudden you're heading back the other way. So it's not a slow 180. It's a pretty abrupt 180. The cool thing is now all of a sudden your dog goes, oh, there's actually somebody else. There's somebody actually walking me. It's like, yep, I've been here the whole time. That's what you want to do. A lot of times, like, you know, we do a ton of food training, but I don't care what you hold up. Whatever's across the street is always going to be more important. That's usually what in your hand. So what I want you to do is when the dog does look up at you, you can always mark it with good, good. You can do physical touch if you want to, physical touch. I think it's hard to deliver a food reward on the walk. I think it's really, you gotta be super coordinated. Now, in a classroom is one thing, but out on the streets, it's really difficult to do. Now, that doesn't mean you can't try that at home doing, like, you know, focus work with food delivery. You can do that, but historically when a dog sees something interesting, like what food? Like, give me a break. It's like, you know what? It's like, I mean, I always use the like person at the strip club. It's like, what? There's food here? I'm not looking at food. I'm looking what's up on stage, right? So, but, you know, so it's the same thing. You put a bunch of women at Chippendales and they'll be like, I don't see a damn thing, you know? So, you know, so I think that's where we have to remember that inside behavior and outside behavior are two different things. Outside behavior, that's why we like tools so much, because outside behavior, what it does is it evens the playing field, because there's so many distractions, you know, there's so many distractions out there. So I would try the 180 move, and then work it. And don't feel like you've got to do, I got to get my 3 miles in today and I've got to do this big around the block. I have clients that are like, I want you walking up and down your street. Two houses that way, two houses this way. Like, I want you to master the walk before you go out into the big wide world. So, and your dog will be mentally exhausted. So they don't need to do like the big loop. They can do just back and forth, because that back and forth is just it perfect. So make it perfect before you go distance.
Okay, well, we've been out there in the distance. We've been out there in the distance, but we're going to work on some focus training, because the last thing that I wanted to say was I have been trying to start a dog walking business, and that got delayed. My thought process was, oh, you know, since I'm going to have these different dogs around and be handling dogs, why don't I get acclimated with one dog, you know, now, and we'll just go. And so now I felt, very discouraged, because I'm like, if I can't, you know, handle my own dog, how am I going to handle someone else's dog, you know, type of thing. And so.
Right. So this is the thing. Do you feel, so say you spend the next month mastering the skills with your dog, but your dog's not perfect, and none of my dogs are even close to perfect. So your dog's not perfect. Do you feel that you can add value to other people's lives?
Yes, because I'm taking care of their dogs. I'm bringing them out, you know, and I'm, you know, I love dogs, and this whole process is to build a nonprofit that will help veterans and other people learn this business and open their own businesses. So
therefore, you can be successful. You will never. Okay. The last thing I would want you to do is wait until you're perfect to give value to other people. You have value now. So, will you be able to work with the most intense leash reactive dog? Maybe not. But guess what? There are thousands of people that do not have that leash reactive dog that need your help. So what you do is, massively leash reactive, you can say, you know what? You know, I'm gonna do 1 or 2 days, no charge. Let me see how it goes. And then after that, you're like, you know what? My skill level is not enough to handle this dog. I'm sorry. Have some good place, you know, people you can recommend to, but you never know. Just because, I mean, this is the thing. You put a dog on a harness, and it's out of control, you throw a prong collar on it and you do proper leash, the dog all of a sudden is the best walker ever. So tools and technique and philosophy go a long way. So you'd be surprised what you can do, but don't ever wait until your dog is perfect before you add value to the universe. Don't.
Thank you very, very much. Thank you. That is so kind of you to say and need it because good. I'm sitting here looking at my time chart and I'm all like, right. Oh my gosh, I'm like 2 months behind and just feeling that was one of the reasons why I was going to return her because yeah, I was like, return her. I didn't want to do that. I was going to try to rehome her is what I was going to do.
The best place for that dog is with you.
That's what they told me.
Yep. The best place is with that dog, with you working on your skills. That literally is the magic recipe. Because you know damn well, as soon as that dog goes somewhere else, it'll be instantly returned because people are not going to care about that dog as much as you do.
Well, you're right about that. Yep. And then she's got some little health issues that's popped up. So I was very slow, too, because I didn't want. And anyway, that's another Oprah show. I'm sure you know where I'm going with that.
I know where you're going.
So, I mean, she's not even letting me have a show anymore. But that's where I just, you know, thank you so much for taking the time today. And I'm watching those videos. Good. And, you know, Sweetie lives another day.
Good. Good job. Thank you for reaching out. All right. Take care.
Thank you. Bye-bye. All right.
Bye-bye.